evening. You're watching Left, Right and Center. I'm Nidhi Razdan. On the show tonight, U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry tells NDTV that Washington is looking forward to ties with India and to Prime Minister Modi's visit to the U.S., saying that it was a different U.S. government that had denied him his visa earlier. As Washington looks to repair what has been a frosty relationship, can India-U.S. ties be rebooted, or is there still a long way to go? Joining us on the program tonight, Ambassador K.C. Singh, former Secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs, Hardeep Puri, former Indian envoy to the United Nations and now member of the BJP. Here in the studio with us, Walter Anderson, Director of the South Asia Studies Program at the Johns Hopkins University. We're lucky that he's visiting us in Delhi at this time. And Gardiner Harris, the South Asia correspondent of the New York Times. I'll take that first to Ambassador K.C. Singh. Mr. Singh, your assessment then of how today's visit has gone. Lots of big words and you know, very positive language certainly that was thrown about by John Kerry before he came here in a column, in the speech that he made. But do you think that's going to be a little harder to translate into reality on the ground?
Well, compared to his last visit, obviously the body language, his general attitude is much more positive, much more forward-looking. Part of the reason may be we have a new government here. And I think U.S. assessment is that this will be more friendly to what U.S. perceived its interests, and he talked about it. But he put the caveat at the end, and he said, taste of the pudding is in the eating. So they are looking at market reforms. They are looking at, obviously, they've been told much more on government's parliamentary agenda, which government has still not shared. We know the insurance bill, etc., is coming in. But they would have been told a lot more than is available to us. But clearly, that is of interest to them. But the trouble points also came out. We saw that he consulted our minister about WTO. I think the meeting is starting now, and today is the last day when a decision has to be taken whether the agreement in Bali is sacrosanct and we stick to it, or it's modified, or the rest of the world moves ahead without us. So that would leave some bruised egos if that happens. But NSA, they put aside very clearly, although minister's own statement to say friendly countries don't spy on each other, that is just really for public consumption. Friendly countries do spy on each other. I think what everyone didn't like is the kind of intrusive and excessive spying which was being done by NSA by scooping up gigabytes of information, storing it away. It is that which countries like Germany, Brazil, they've taken exception to. But there is, overall, I would say it looked positive. But to re-quote Secretary Kerry, we also would like to see that the proof of the pudding is in the eating.
Walter Anderson, did it look positive to you as well? Is there any substance, do you think, to this visit? Is it just on the surface?
Well, I think the surface counts. Before the Secretary came here, he gave a speech in which he said that this was an extremely important relationship. And the reason the surface counts is because the last few years there has been something of a drift. And I think you have to sort of put it in the context of an important relationship so that it has an impact on the bureaucracies at home in our country as well as in India to handle the specific issues, several of which came up in the conversation now. So there has to be a follow-up. The first step was good. In fact, the very first step was the president's call to the prime minister soon after his swearing in. And then you had a number of visits here, the invitation to go to Washington, and the prime minister's acceptance of that almost immediately. So I think that, you know, the atmosphere is good. Atmosphere is important because it sends a message to the bureaucracy.
Mr. Puri, would you agree with that the atmosphere is definitely more positive as we go ahead from here? But, you know, there are, you know, issues of serious difference as well. And as we've already mentioned, the WTO being among them, do you, for instance, think that it is possible to have a meeting ground on that issue?
Well, an effort is being made to create a positive atmosphere. I think both the pre-visit vibes that came, the statement that the Secretary of State made there, you know, trying to reach out to the new Indian government, that is positive, and that is how it should be. Having said that, I would say that the issues which are contentious are not likely to be resolved through just one plenary meeting. Let me take up the WTO trade facilitation agreement, something with which I have some familiarity. I am not persuaded by those who say that, you know, this is a deadline. the GATT, the predecessor instrument to the WTO and the WTO now, have a long history of missed deadlines. Now, the issue from India's point of view is not a trade issue. This is an issue of livelihood of farmers. We have more poor people than all the poor people in the least developed countries of the world put together. Now, it is ridiculous to suggest that we should be using 1986 and 1987 reference prices to work out the aggregate measurement of support. All that is required, and we are not against a trade facilitation agreement. All we are saying is that, look, let's get some clarity and definition on food security. Whether it's good or not, I'm not going into the merits of the system. It should not take too much of an effort by the United States to accommodate us on that, but I don't see tangible movement on that. Again, on NSA snooping, I agree with Casey. I think the situation is far more complicated. We have a situation now where all the information is in the public domain. I think our minister, Sushma, was not left with any choice but to say what she had to, because that is for domestic consumption. But most important, we need a rectification. It is quite possible that you don't discuss intelligence details, but if you have top secret documents floating around in books being written by Mr. Greenwald and others, which are mentioning the nature of the programs used on India, somebody in India is going to read them, they will get into the press. And if your concern was in counter-terrorism, how is the Indian delegation to the United Nations in 2010 or the BJP in 2010 being snooped on? Is there the suggestion that it was resorting to actions which have that kind of a dimension?
But so I just want to ask you on this question of snooping. You know that there has been a criticism in the past, even when these revelations first came out about the NSA and its surveillance of not just embassies and diplomats, but even world leaders, there's always been a sense that the Indian government just hasn't reacted strongly enough to it. You've seen other world leaders, who have really, really strongly reacted to this. And you know, is it just for domestic consumption that Sushma Swaraj said this? Shouldn't we be more outraged?
No. I think Casey started off. Let me try and annotate that a bit. I think Brazil and Germany reacted strongly. Brazil called off a state visit to Washington. I don't think that is what India should be doing. But India should be making its sense of hurt and the fact that we are outraged known to the American side. And I think that is what the External Affairs Minister did today. But having said that, you need correction. You need to ensure that entities are not looking at all our system. To the extent our systems are flawed, we need to take domestic corrective measures. But you cannot have a situation that, you know, arrangements implanted in 2010 are still continuing today. So I think this is an incremental step ahead. We have many more important relationships, contentious issues also to sort out in this relationship. So I think we've gone about it the right way, one small step at a time. But as the minister said, we have a lot of work ahead. You couldn't expect any positive results. All you have is positive vibes and an attempt to look positive. You'll have to do a lot of work between today and September 30th when the summit level discussions
I'm going to come to that and the expectations from that summit level meeting. But Gardiner Harris, John Kerry seems to have come with certain expectations, and especially on trade and the Indian economy and the Indian economy opening up. Now, do you think, from the American point of view, is India heading there, or are we still a long way away from that?
Right. I mean, I think Americans have been coming to India for the last 10 years, particularly with huge expectations, great hopes, this sense that the Americans bring flowers, they bring chocolates, and they think they're going to sort of wow the Indians. And the Indians really have sort of stiff-armed the Americans for a long time. The Indians are just not quite as into this relationship, I think, as the Americans want them to be.
Really? Because the Indians think that it's you guys who are not into it.
Well, I think obviously there's a couple of things going on. The Indians sort of constantly want the Americans to kind of bring checks to, you heard Pranoy, your boss, talk about, why can't you just solve the WTO? Why can't you just solve the nuclear agreement? Well, the Americans can't actually do that. You know, it's companies like Westinghouse and GE that decide to invest in India. And they will decide to invest in India when India changes the laws that allow them to invest.
But the French and the Russians are.
But those are government directed investments. Those are not free market sort of situations. The United States, you know, what the disconnect between India and the United States is often that India is still a fairly socialist statist economy that has great control over huge sections of its economy, whereas the Americans simply don't. John Kerry is not nearly as powerful as the Indians sort of think he should be. And this also came up in the Kobergati episode. There was this sort of big sense that John Kerry, the Kobergati arrest was sort of coming out of John Kerry without really any understanding that he had absolutely no power over it and had nothing to do with it. So the real sort of disconnect that often happens between the Americans and the Indians is the Indians are looking for the Americans to deliver something that the Americans can't possibly deliver. And so the Americans sort of say, look, we'll bring it to you if you change your investment rules, if you do some of these things. And to the Indians, that sounds like the Americans are sort of demanding, instead of bringing goods, the Americans are demanding things. Whereas the Chinese, of course, can just write a check and say, you want, you know, infrastructure? We'll write you a check. Many of the, you know, the Russians can just sort of say, yeah, we'll do that because it's all state driven.
That's an interesting take. And I just want to ask Walter Anderson that, especially what Gardiner said about whether it was India that seemed less interested in this relationship or the United States, because the view from here certainly seems to have been for a while that after his 2010 visit, President Obama was the one who kind of let the relationship slide. Now, do you share that view or you believe that it's India that's...
No, I think it was the problem on both sides. There was a slide. And what happens when there is a slide is that bureaucracies with single issue behind them begin to shape the relationship, which is exactly what happened in this case. And I think you see that in some of the comments that are made here on some of the issues like the WTO, the nuclear issue, and there are a few others. When the leadership, you know, puts pressure on the bureaucracy to make compromises on these sorts of issues, and it's required on both sides, that they do that, because on both sides there are issues on the other side, because on both sides you've got bureaucracies with pushing single issues that have sort of taken control of an issue, and that tends to undermine the relationship. So what happens, the important thing is not what's happened here that's important, is what happens next in terms of, you know, pushing these various issues through. It's the next stage that's important.